Spirit's work, who dwells in us, who seals the promise. God's love through time and all eternity shall stand, and we shall stand upon it. What now could separate us from
Good morning, everyone. This morning, we don't have any instruments. They're all having a beautiful and well-deserved break, or they're busy doing other things. So it's just going to be us three beautiful singers today. Thank you very much, Christine and Amanda, for helping me. Some of these songs at the end especially are going to be sung a cappella. I would like this service to be about worship, about listening to God, to contemplate on the words, especially on the songs that we have picked that are backing up, that cannot be altered. Sometimes there might be gaps between the verses or the choruses. Please just meditate on the words that you're singing today. So the first verse I'm going to read is Proverbs 18:10. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous man runs into it and is safe. Please stand and sing as we sing Jesus Strong and Kind.
Jesus said that if I thirst, I should come to Him. No one else can satisfy, I should come to Him. Jesus said if I am weak, I should come to Him. No one else can be my strength, I should come to Him. For the Lord is good and faithful, He will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong and kind. Jesus said that if I fear, I should come to Him. No one else can be my shield, I should come to Him. For the Lord is good and faithful, He will keep us steady. Jesus said, if I am lost, he will come to me. And he showed me on that cross, he will come to me. For the Lord is good and faithful, he will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong and kind. For the Lord is good and faithful, he will keep us day and night.
Psalm 63, verse 7 and 8. Because you are my help, I sing in the shadow of your wings. I cling to you. Your right hand upholds me. Let's sing the heart of worship.
When the music fades, and all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to pray. Something that's a word that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. King of endless wealth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus.
Please bow your heads in prayers. Lord, I pray that today's worship service will bring your hearts willing and ready to praise your name in all its purest forms. Forgive everything that we've done wrong. Forgive our trespasses. Help us to forgive others. Help us to worship you today in love, because you love us. And Lord, we are only created
for your glory. Help us to lift our arms, our voices, our hearts in praise today for you. And Lord, please help us to continue that into the week after this service is long gone. I pray these things in Jesus' name.
Matthew 13, verse 15. For this people's heart has become calloused. They hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes. Jesus said, otherwise they might see with their eyes, they might hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn, and I would heal them. Let's sing, Open the Eyes of My Heart, Lord.
Oh, yeah. Things for the way they really are. Open our eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Lift it up, let me hear you.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
To see you high.
To see you high and lifted up. Shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you, to see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. To see you high and lifted up, shining of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. High and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. See you.
Amanda's got announcements.
All right, please be seated. Okay. So if you've seen some of the members sporting their new name badges, they look really amazing. So there's been a few requests that they would like to jump on and grab one too. So there will be a second order placed. There is a QR code up on the back of the sound desk that you can scan for that. The cost is $11.80, and you can pay online deposit with the name, with the reference name badge, or just pop it in an envelope in the offering each week. Orders must be placed by the 29th of March, and Sarah will order them when she returns from Townsville. We have Sam Childers, the Machine Gun Preacher event coming up this month, also on the 29th of March. If you are able to come along to this event, please feel free to bring a friend and a plate of food to share for supper after the event. We're also seeking someone who's willing to help serve in the kitchen. If you're able to help in this way, please let Tim or Sarah know. We'll be taking up a love offering that Sunday is, for that event as well, so please come prepared for that. Finally, the church directories are ready for distribution. See Pastor Tim after the service if you would like one, as you will need to sign your copy out for privacy reasons.
Okay. After the song. All right, Psalm 51, verse 10 to 11. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Please stand as we sing Create in Me a Clean Heart. Embrace yourself, it's a cappella, so just sing after us.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me.
Please be seated. And children, it's time to go. Sunshine Corner is prep to year three, and Junior Church is just in the back of there. It's year 4 to 6. And this is the Bible reading for today. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 to 22. Therefore, remember that formerly you were Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who called themselves the circumcision, which is done in the body by human hands. Remember that at the time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners to covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near by God, the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has been made by two groups. One has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which we put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who were far away and peace to those who were near. For through him, we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. Pastor Tim, if you'd like to come up for the sermon.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's wonderful to have you here this morning. Welcome if you're a visitor or a guest. The Boys Brigade camp is on, so if you're wondering where our normal production team and a number of our singers and things are, they're at Cloncurry currently. Just a few things before I jump right in. Carl's mother died last Sunday evening. So Carl and Lynn have both flown down to Melbourne to be with the family. So we'll keep them in prayer. That just means that there's no a youth Bible study after the service. It's regrettably Hugo and Moira's last day with us for about 3 months. God willing, they need to go back to South Africa for the sake of their visa. But by God's grace, they might have a visa agent to fast track them and get them back sort of within that 3 months. So we'll pray for them, but make sure you say farewell and safe travels to them. Chase Cropp's surgery, I mentioned that last week. His surgery was delayed for 2 weeks. He came down with a cold or a flu or something like that, so they needed to push his surgery back. And Rael Beard and the Beards have gone down to Townsville for surgery for Rael getting her tonsils and adenoids out, so we'll keep them in prayer. And you might have just seen on Facebook, we had some visitors at the church this week escaping the rain, but regrettably, they were committed to drinking the whole week, and so disturbing the neighbours with a boombox and things like that, to the point on Friday there was a physical assault of two teenage girls on the property. The police responded quickly, so we'll pray, commit that to prayer with people coming in from various parts. But there also might be a need just to fence that area off, just to prevent that from occurring. We've got some quotes, but they're quite expensive, so if there's a few guys who are in a position to help do that and consider that, just let me know. So let me pray. Now, Father, we read in Psalm 12 that the words of the Lord are pure words, like silver refined in a furnace on the ground. And we trust that what we hear today would be more worth than the treasures of this life. We pray that we would love your church and ensure that we hear your word and build on the right foundation. Well, we're at the last sermon in chapter 2 after several months, and I trust you see just how densely packed Ephesians is. When I finished my formal theological study in 2014, I'd spent 7 years both in undergraduate and postgraduate study, so I spent much of that period, 7 years, in a library, in books, in study, typing, not much else. Now, at the same time when I finished my study, I was also working as the part-time youth pastor at Tent Hill Baptist Church in the Lockyer Valley near Gatton. It was a wonderful church. And so when my studies came to an end, one of the members of that church, who was a builder, a man by the name of Murray, offered me work so that I could work with him and also continue working at the church and have a full-time job between the two. Now, the first day of work, Murray had me on a jackhammer. So I went from spending 7 years in a library to a jackhammer on my first day of working. And each day I came home, I crashed on the couch, and Ness had to bring me a thick shake and put the straw right up to my mouth because I was so unable to move. One of the other jobs I did with Murray was laying a foundation for a large packing shed. You know, as you do, there's a measure of dirt that is removed, there's a slab that is laid, deep holes are drilled for the metal framework that would form the basis of the building. And the purpose of a foundation is rather simple. We want buildings that stand and last, even in spite of the storms and the winds and the shifting soil. And so you lay the foundation first. Now, we spent some time in these verses, and last week we looked at that description of the people of God being a living and holy temple. But I didn't want to move on to chapter 3, and in fact, we're going to have a little bit of a break just to give you a breather from Ephesians for a few weeks. But I didn't want to move on from Ephesians chapter 2 without specifically addressing what Paul says in verse 20, that the church is built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Now, in these verses, Paul has been emphasizing two things in particularly. The first is that the unity that must exist between the members of the church, Jews, Gentiles, and by extension, all people, all languages, all backgrounds are united into this family around the work of Christ. And the second matter that we've seen in the last few weeks is that Paul has been emphasizing the benefits that we have as members of this family, that we are citizens of the kingdom, we are members of the family of God, and we have access to the Father. But now we consider one more important truth, and that is the matter of unity, the matter of privileges and benefits, and of remaining a holy church. And the point is that all of these stand, the unity that we have, the holiness that we have, all stand or fall on the foundation on which we build. If we as a church build on a different foundation, we're not going to end with those results of holiness and unity. And so this is a fundamental question for us that we as a church, we need to have an answer on. What is the nature of the church and what is the foundation on which we are building? Let's just say you move to a new town. You might ask yourself, what is your guiding principle for attending any particular given church? Now, the first question be, well, what's stopping you from attending the Mormon church or the Jehovah's Witness or any other cult, religious cult there? And then there might be various other churches in town, many which are hopefully suitable. But what would make you choose one church over the other? And I hope that one of the guiding principles is that the church you're attending is building on the right foundation. And once you've joined that church, are you going to be a hindrance and say, well, I like what you're doing, but let's go start building over this area or this area because of things that I've seen elsewhere? Or are you going to be a help by building on the same foundation, the right foundation, so that the living church remains intact and grows in a godly and biblical fashion? Now, the English Baptists in the 17th century found themselves on the wrong side of the state church because in that period, the Church of England was maintaining the order of the church through a strict uniformity and did so at risk of punishment. You know, John Bunyan went to jail for 12 years. Many Baptists went to jail and had their property confiscated. Only state-registered ministers could serve and had to do so using the state-sanctioned prayer books. And it caused the Baptist Christopher Blackwood in 1644 to make this statement in one of his tracts defending Baptist distinctives. God prefers the peace of his servants' consciences before the show of a glorious uniformity, a glorious uniformity. And so the Church of England was enforcing uniformity. And they might have made for a large, uniform church, but it didn't necessarily make for saints who were committed to the Word of God above all else and who were at peace when they worship God. So church unity cannot be enforced at the end of the sword, which was what the Baptists experienced in England in the 17th century. When we build a church, unity, while very important, cannot be the guiding principle. Even other good things cannot be made the guiding principles. Things like love and unity, peace between the saints, all very important, but these are all the consequence or the results of something far more fundamental. Now, sometimes I struggle with a very broad ecumenicalism, cooperation with churches and denominations, especially with denominations or pastors who have let go of a historic Christian orthodoxy and have been swept up with the spirit of the age, perhaps on matters of marriage as is happening at the moment. And if that happens, the question is, can we in good conscience, or I in good conscience, have even a loose fellowship when we're working together? Our Australian attitude is often we go along to get along. But consider Paul's words on this matter in Galatians chapter 1. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to the one we preach to you, let him be accursed. And so Paul is very severe in his warning of those who preach another gospel. He says that they are accursed. They are cut off from Christ. They are not in Christ because they don't regard Christ as all sufficient. They have added, subtracted, or distorted the word of God. And so Paul is speaking of churches and pastors and people who preach another gospel, who have built on another foundation. And their ministries, their churches have formed incorrectly. And we would say, you might look in and say, well, what's that room there? I don't recognize that room on God's plan. What's this grotesque architecture? What's this obscure obstruction that's coming out of your church, as it were? And the last thing we want to do is, through accommodation, being accommodating, bring things back into our own church, although they might be popular in culture, but are in fact not what Christ has commanded. And so we must be careful, having unity as our overarching principle. Unity at all costs means that we will sacrifice the truth. And Martin Luther said we need peace, if possible, truth at all costs. So we must observe the God-given plans for the building. Unity not based on truth is a false unity. It doesn't help the church, and it doesn't please God. And so, as much as we desire for the living temple of God, for the church to grow, for us to be united and to be holy, it can only do so when certain conditions are met. And so when we talk about church growth and the building of the church, we must start with the foundation. Now, just another real-world example, what happens when the foundations fail? You end up with something like the Leaning Tower of Pisa. Now, we would say this is a beautiful building that attracts thousands of people each year, but would you trust it to stand indefinitely? Would you want to keep building and say, well, let's build a few more levels on top of this? And of course not, you wouldn't do that. If there's a lean, the problem is likely with the foundation. And regrettably, you can't just put a few more layers of drywall on that to fix it up. You need to likely demolish it and start again, and start with the foundation. And how much more so with the church? And so Paul gives us the right foundation, that there can be no true temple of the Lord without a right foundation. If you want to be, if you want these wonderful benefits that we've spoken about, you need to start at the base, at the foundation. And what is the foundation that we build on? Well, we've just read it out, the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone. Now, as I've hinted, there have been many Christians and local churches that have probably, with good intentions, tried to build on other foundations. And there's countless amounts of books and conferences that tell you to grow the church, you infuse these tried and tested methods, appeal to this demographic, market this way. And the likely outcome is that we will end up with a church that doesn't know what it is if we've abandoned the foundation. So we must start by building on the proper foundation. And Paul tells us that the foundations are the apostles and the prophets. So what are the apostles? The first one is, there's apostles and prophets. Who or what are the apostles? And it's a very simple answer. The apostles were those men who had seen the risen Lord. This is what qualified someone to be an apostle. Now, Paul also fits this definition. He saw the risen Lord in a vision. He wasn't there among the initial 12. But he saw the living Christ in a vision as he traveled to Damascus. And we see this in 1 Corinthians 15. Paul says of himself, last of all, as to one untimely born, meaning that he came after those initial apostles, he appeared also to me. So if Paul didn't have this vision, he wouldn't be qualified for this office as apostle. He He might have been a pastor, an evangelist, a godly elder, but not an apostle. But Paul had an especial encounter with the risen Jesus to qualify him for this role. And the apostles were given an important task to lay the foundation of the gospel so that it lined up correctly with Jesus Christ, the cornerstone. They were given special authority. They were given powers to work miracles. As a demonstration of this authority, we see this in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. The signs of a true apostle were performed among you with utmost patience, with signs and wonders and mighty works. And so the apostles founded the churches. They were given the responsibility of correctly laying the gospel as the foundation of these churches, and they worked miracles as a demonstration of their authority. These are the marks of a true apostle. They had seen the risen Christ. They were entrusted with the task of proclaiming the gospel with power and authority, and they lay the foundation for the gospel and the churches. Now, there's a counter-reference in Revelation chapter 21 about the foundation of the apostles. And the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and on them were the 12 names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. And so the apostles laid the foundation for us to enjoy the blessings of this coming kingdom. Now, all of that is important to keep in mind because there is a question: has the authority of the apostles been entrusted down through the ages with the likes of popes and bishops? Or a similar question: should we expect modern-day apostles today? I was once in a church where the pastor appointed himself an apostle and took for himself extra powers over the church. He became more like a dictator, I remember. And so we'll look at that in a second. But first, let's consider what Paul means here when he speaks of the prophets. Now, when you read through the various commentaries, the understanding of who the prophets are falls into two groups. The first is that this is referring to the prophets of the Old Testament only. Moses, Elijah, Isaiah, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, the major and minor prophets, those who laid the foundation for the Old Testament. The second perspective is that this is referring to not only the Old Testament prophets, but also the New Testament prophets. And so, for example, in Acts chapter 11, we read, "Now in these days, prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch, and one of them named Agabus stood up and foretold by the Spirit that there would be a great famine over all the church, and this took place in the days of Claudius." So these are prophets functioning in the New Testament church. And one of the reasons that this second perspective holds weight is that Paul says apostles first, he says apostles, and then he says prophets second. If he had meant only the Old Testament prophets, he would have likely said prophets and apostles. But he says apostles first. And so we can say at the very least that there were authoritative prophets operating in the New Testament early church prior to the formation of Scripture. So what then is a prophet, both in terms of Old Testament and New Testament terms? Let me provide you Martin Lloyd-Jones's definition. A prophet is one whom the truth is revealed directly by the Spirit, not as a result of reading the Scripture or anything else, but by a direct message given them, which he in turn is to impart to others. And so in the New Testament church, as Scripture was still being written, the churches couldn't pick up a Bible as we can today and say, this is the Word of God. The Gospels of Paul's letters were still being written. And so they had these prophets to provide spiritual truth direct revelation to the church. The very voice of God was speaking through them, as did the Old Testament prophets did as well. You'll read in the Old Testament those authoritative words, "Thus says the Lord," or "Thus saith the Lord," meaning these men spoke with the very authority of God as though God was speaking through them, meaning that they couldn't err, they couldn't be in error, they couldn't be wrong. This is what it means when Paul says a prophet. And so we have the apostles, we have the prophets. And Paul says this is the foundation of the church. The whole superstructure of the living temple of God rests on these men and their office. But what way can we say this is true, that this is they make the foundation? You know, we can say, well, these men were believers who placed their faith in the Lord. But of course, it means more than that, because we too are believers and we have faith in God, but I wouldn't regard any of us to be apostles or prophets in any authoritative sense of the word in which God is giving us direct revelation. It was the apostles and the prophets who laid the foundation. And we are to build on this structure as we are unified and squared around the truth that the apostles and prophets have given us. Ask another question. Why are you here this morning? Why are you here, and why are there people on any given Sunday morning who perhaps have nothing to do with any given church in any given town? Why are we here, and why are there other people not here? Well, the reason is because you believe something. You believe something, and other people don't believe something. And what do you believe? Well, you believe in the teaching of the apostles and the prophets. The foundation is the teaching of these men. That is the foundation of the church, the teaching of the apostles and prophets. They gave substance to our faith. We'd have no reason to be here if we had nothing to teach or to talk about. John Stott said it like this. Since apostles and prophets were both groups with a teaching role, it seems clear that what constitutes the church's foundation is neither their person nor their office, but their instruction, what they have passed down through the ages. The teaching of these men is the foundation of the church, or as Jude says it, the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. This is the foundation, the faith that has been delivered down through the ages. And this is vitally important to grasp. We are in a generation that has likely lower biblical literacy than previous generations, and the church is in a dangerous position of being, as Paul says, tossed to and fro by waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemes. Now, you can go online and into a Christian bookstore and find some wonderful teachers, but you can also find a whole lot that will lead you astray and who have shoddy foundations. So how can we be sure that we are building on the right foundation? Well, it's our acceptance of the teaching and doctrine of the apostles and the prophets. Is that what you are building your faith on? If not, what do you intend to build it on? Where else are you going to go for a divinely inspired word of God? Now, Paul says, I'm astonished that you are so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel. Not that there is another one, but there are some who trouble you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. And so Paul is most intolerant when he comes to defining the faith. And that should be our strong conviction as well, that what we have in Scripture is right and true and the very word of God. And if someone should add to Scripture or subtract from Scripture or distort Scripture, Paul says, let them be accursed. Let them be judged by God. And so there's no other gospel that has been handed down to us through the apostles and prophets. This is the gospel that we have. Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, for no one can lay a foundation other than which is laid, which is Christ, which is Jesus Christ. And so the basis of growth for unity is found on this foundation. The question is not, you know, what is my opinion about any given matter on the church or theology or life and faith? You know, this is my opinion. We need to ask, well, what does the Word of God teach about this? What did the apostles and the prophets hand down to us about this matter? We don't get to add things to our faith just because it's popular in the culture around us. We have a foundation that remains strong and true and tried and tested down through the ages. And the Christian conviction is that what we believe is objectively true. That it's true for me just as it's true for someone in the world who doesn't believe it. It is true for everyone whether they believe it or not. And we've gone through what the foundation of the gospel is, particularly over the last few months. Paul recaps the foundation in Ephesians chapter 2, that man by nature is under the wrath of God, is dead in trespasses in sin, under the wrath of God, under the anger of God, and that man deserves death and hell. This is what has been handed down to us, and that you must believe to be a Christian. If you don't believe that there's such a thing as sin, and that sin is met by God's anger, then you're not building on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets. Now, this foundation doesn't stop there. The foundation of the church tells us that Jesus Christ acted for our benefit. Jesus Christ, the perfect Son of God, shed his blood on the cross as a sacrifice and substitute for our sin. And it is only through the blood of Christ that we are saved, that we are brought near to the Father. The division between Jew and Gentile, between nations and backgrounds, are broken down in Jesus Christ. And if you do not believe that, then you are not a Christian. And it's untenable to think that we can pretend to be in Christian fellowship with people who would take the name of Christ but deny this very foundation. Chapter 2 of Ephesians summarizes the very heart of what the apostles and the prophets handed down to us. And the reason why we spent so long here, it is the gospel compacted into 22 verses. This is the good news, that Christ bore our sins on the body of a tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. The Spirit brings me new life, brings new life as well. We are united to Christ, and finally, we are truly alive. This is the foundation. Paul preached Christ and him crucified, and we build on this foundation. So the application is that churches must know that they are what we're building on. And it's the role of elders to make sure of this. And for you as congregation, as the congregation, to be noble Bereans and to compare what I teach or what anyone teaches in this pulpit or in the various ministries with Scripture. And the noble Bereans, as you know in Acts, went back to Scripture after Paul had preached and said, "Were it so, was this true?" Now, there's some other application here as well. The foundation of the church is the apostles and prophets. Now, in several denominations, you'll find what is called apostolic succession, that apostolic authority has been passed down through the popes, through bishops, particularly coming from Peter. And this idea comes from Matthew 16:18. There, Peter confesses to Jesus, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus says, "I tell you, Peter, and on this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." So rock, foundation, on this rock I will build my church. Now the Catholic Church answers by saying the rock, the foundation, is Peter. And he hands down his authority through the popes and the bishops. Now Protestants answer by saying that the foundation, or the rock, is Peter's confession, that Jesus is the Christ. And so Peter sees and understands the truth of who Jesus is, and so he confesses it. And that's how Protestants understand it, that the foundation is Peter's confession. And so Protestants understand that the authority of the church isn't based on apostolic succession from one pope to another, to one bishop to another. Now, in his 1905 Baptist History, John Carlyle wrote this: "After all, the only apostolic succession that can be proved or is worth proving is the succession of the truth held by the apostles, the instruction held by the apostles that's handed down through the ages." Now, this was a very practical question for the first English Baptists. John Smith and Thomas Ellis, regarded as the first Baptists, did not receive their rebaptism. They were rebaptized, but they didn't receive their rebaptism through bishops of the state church. These were the men who held the authority to do so. They didn't go to those men to be rebaptized. In about 1610, John Smith is said to have baptized himself and then baptized his friend Thomas Ellis. Again, in the 1640s, in the state church forbid unordained men to preach, punishing men like John Bunyan for preaching, and sent John Bunyan to jail for 12 years. But the Baptists rejected even this type of authoritative succession. Rather, it was any man with the passion, the giftings, the courage, and who had been identified by the church to preach. To state it plainly, Baptists do not believe in apostolic succession. That is what was written in John Cramp's 1871 work on Baptist history. Now, the second application is that there can be no addition to this foundation. We cannot add to this instruction. We cannot add to the teaching of the apostles and the prophets. And there can be no repetition of the apostles and prophets. A foundation is laid only once. You don't build a building and then go, well, let's lay a second foundation under that building. Otherwise, you have to rip everything up and start again. And so my perspective is that there are no successors to the apostles. Sometimes the word is used to speak of a special type of authority given to people in the church, a church planter, a gifted leader. But here I would agree with John Stott again. The word apostles here cannot therefore be a generic term for missionaries or church planters or bishops or other church leaders. Instead, it must denote that small and special group whom Jesus chose, called and authorized to teach in his name, and who were eyewitnesses of his resurrection, consisting of the 12, plus James and perhaps one or two others. What they taught, they expected the church to believe and preserve, that they commanded, they expected the church to obey. So I believe it's dangerous and confusing for someone to use the title of apostle today. You know, are they suggesting that they are laying a new foundation? Are they adding to the foundation? Did they see the risen Christ as Paul and the apostles did? Did Christ entrust them with that message or a new message? Has Christ personally endowed them with miraculous gifts? Did they speak in an infallible manner without error, that's absolutely true and trustworthy, free from error? I would personally run away from anyone who took the title of apostle. Now, what do we say about prophets? And again, I'd agree with John Stott here. The word prophets also indicates inspired teachers to whom the word of God came to and who conveyed the word to others faithfully. The reference to prophets must again be to a small group of inspired teachers associated with the apostles who together bore witness to Christ and whose teaching was derived from revelation and was foundational. In practical terms, this means that the church is built on the New Testament scriptures. They are the church's foundation documents. And just as a foundation cannot be tampered with once it has been laid and the superstructure is being built on it, so the New Testament church, foundation of the church, is inviolable and cannot be changed by any additions, subtractions, or modifications offered by teachers who claim to be apostles or prophets today. The church stands or falls by its loyal dependence on the foundation truth which God revealed to his apostles and prophets and which are now preserved in the New Testament scriptures. Now, just to answer a common question, the question of prophecy or having a prophetic voice does come up today. You know, should we expect any type of prophecy? And don't take this as scripture, take this as probably my growing understanding, but and my personal thoughts on the subject. But throughout the church age, we do see men and women who speak with biblical authority, not getting new words from scripture, but with biblical authority, with courage, who challenge injustice, who challenge the state, who provide warnings to the church, who speak like John the Baptist when he said to King Herod, "It's not lawful to have your brother's wife." And John the Baptist was considered an eccentric and thrown in jail. But I think we see some voices like this in history as well. For example, the first Baptist leader, John Smith, who I just mentioned, wrote to King James. The King James Bible has his namesake, and who was persecuting Baptists at the time. John Smith wrote to King James, who was the persecutor of the Baptists, and said, "The king is a mortal man and not God." Imagine telling a king that. "You are a mortal man and not God. Therefore, he hath no power over the immortal souls of his subjects to make laws and ordinances for them and to set spiritual lords over them. If the king has authority to make spiritual lords and laws, then he's an immortal God and not a mortal man," saying that the king has no power over the souls, the spiritual souls of men. He has that role of the magistrate over people, but not spiritual authority. And so John Smith had this courage to understand scripture, understand the age, and to speak, much like John the Baptist did, to challenge the power of the king. And John Smith ended up in prison. Now, one of the reasons I read Francis Schaeffer so much is because he also had a clear understanding of Scripture. He had a clear understanding of the trajectory of secularism. And he sounded, in his warnings, if you read any of his work, if you've seen any of his videos, he sounded clear and accurate warnings, much like the prophets did. So, for example, in his 1981 book, Christian Manifesto, Schaeffer wrote this: "I hope the windows do not close. I hope those with a humanistic worldview who have increasingly controlled our culture for the last 20, 30, 40 years cannot close the open window with all their efforts. But if they do, if they take over with increased power and control, will we be so foolish as to think that religion and the religious institutions will not be even further affected when they have been so far? I wonder how many of us are aware of the cases that the churches have faced in the last 10 years in various places. The things that have been brought into courts of law should make your hair stand on end. Do you think that in such a case I have portrayed, and may it not happen, that the Christians and the Christian institutions will not be even further affected?" And then in that same book, A Christian Manifesto, Schaeffer gave clear warnings of what Christians would likely experience very soon. Would ministers be liable for malpractice to a counselee for using spiritual guidance rather than psychological or medical techniques? Would Christian teachers in public schools be allowed to meet before class for prayer? Should a religious school, a Christian school, accept as a teacher an otherwise qualified practicing homosexual? This is one of the battles that the ACL, I believe, is fighting right now. And Schaeffer highlighted those issues and many more 40 years ago, if you read his work. And we're faced with many of those things that he warned about. And so Schaeffer tried to warn the church and was considered, from what I understand, an eccentric, a radical. But he was right and sounded clear warnings to the church. And so although I don't believe the office of prophet continues today, men who speak a word directly given to them by God, from my perspective, I see that there are men and women who act and speak with courage and with warning, as John the Baptist did, sounding to Herod, "It is not lawful for you to take your brother's wife." And so this is how I would personally take any type of prophetic voice today. People who God raises up, who apply scripture clearly against all odds, daring to address matters of injustice both in the church and outside of the church. Let me wrap up. The Apostle John writes these words: "These things are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." And the practical application is that as Christians, we can know what we believe. We have objective truth. We can know what we believe. And this is what we build our lives on and our church on. That is the apostolic and prophetic teaching that has been passed down through the ages. And it's this truth that saves us. It is this truth that makes us holy. It's this truth that prepares us for heaven, equips us for service. And we might look at a church or a denomination and think, well, look at the size, look at their leaders. They must be doing something right. But Paul never judges the church by size, but rather what concerns Paul is faithfulness to the teaching that has been passed down and the effect that that should have on the saints, making us more holy. And so we praise God where this is happening, whether in big churches and big denominations or small churches and small denominations. And if someone came along saying they have a message, a new message from God, they'd want to take the pulpit. They've come in through, I've had this once before on a Sunday morning. They've said they had a new message from God and they wanted to speak. I'd be extremely skeptical. Men have done that before and have led entire churches astray, men like Joseph Smith of the Mormons, Charles Taze Russell of the Jehovah's Witness. And your desire as a congregation should be that whoever stands in front of this pulpit, now and in the future, opens the Word of God and explains what God has passed down through the apostles and the prophets. Now, the apostles and the prophets laid the foundation, but Paul says, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone. The foundation can only be laid only after the cornerstone is in place. Every other piece of the building is affected by the cornerstone. And Christ is the cornerstone of the church. He sustains and bears the weight of the entire building. And every part of the building is formed in relationship to him. And so there's no truth, there's no unity, there's no salvation, and ultimately no hope for you and for anyone in this church unless we align ourselves with Christ and the foundation that he has set. And so I ask, what do you believe about Christ? Have you based your life, your belief on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets that have squared their teaching upon Christ? Or are you interested in a vague Christianity that calls for love, for tolerance, for unity, but really has no foundation for any of that because it values unity above truth? If you think back to Galatians, Paul was willing to part ways with Peter over the doctrine of justification. Peter was eating with the Jews, but when the Gentiles came, he withdrew. And Paul offered a stern rebuke and was willing to part ways with Peter because of that. And we must build the church on truth. And finally, I would implore you as a church, require that your pastors, your elders, build on this foundation alone so that you aren't led astray. Now, I have a video by way of close of a pastor, an evangelical pastor from the Church of England, fighting these very battles. There's a number of them, but I've just got one, fighting this very battle at the moment on the matter of marriage, pleading with the bishops to return to the foundational teaching and not to introduce into the church new teaching. And it serves as a reminder of the consequences of what happens if you were to require anything less from me or from the elders or even our own denominational leaders. So,
Ben John, St. Albans 395. What our world needs, whether they know it or not, is the gospel. They need the Saviour, Jesus Christ. Don't we all? The Jesus who washes, sanctifies, and justifies us. The hope, the gospel for all of us, whatever our struggles and sins and temptations, is that in Christ we are forgiven and that our sins and desires no longer define us. As Paul says, such were some of you. We do not need to hold on to sinful identities and behaviors. We have not been given a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear. We have been given a spirit of adoption as sons and daughters by whom we cry, Abba, Father. These proposals are wrong. They say that Jesus doesn't wash and sanctify you, that you do not need to take up your cross and follow him, that there is no call to holiness, that the truth does not set you free. But love rejoices in the truth. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing. Love calls people out of sin and to Christ, snatching them out of the fire with discipline so that their spirits might be saved. Please, bishops, I plead with you, withdraw the proposals and prayers. Turn from this path that you are on. Fear God, not man. Be the shepherds that God is calling you to be. Protect the sheep entrusted into your care by driving out this teaching that perverts the grace of God into a license for immorality. This teaching that tickles our ears to suit our desires. A teaching that leads to the broad road and not the narrow one. It's not too late. Turn to the beautiful, wonderful, glorious gospel. Why make ourselves like the world when we have the one thing that the world needs? The gospel of Jesus Christ, where we receive our true identities as precious daughters and treasured sons of God. Amen.
It's a wonderful display of him pleading with the bishops to maintain or return to the foundation. Well, let me pray. Father, we thank you for your word to us today. It's our great desire to build on the right foundation. Please help us build on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets. That is the instructions that have been handed down to us and that you have preserved for us in your word. Help me and the elders be faithful in guarding the truth of your word, and help my people desire for us to guard this word for them. Father, we lift up Carl and Lynn Weech with being down with their family after the death of Carl's mother. We pray that you might grant them peace and your comfort, and pray that they might be a godly witness. Lord, we lift up Hugo and Moira as they return to South Africa for several months. Father, we pray that you might grant them safety and a quick return. Lord, we love having them and their friendship and their fellowship and their wisdom, Lord. We desire to see them very soon. Lord, we lift up Chase Kropp and Rael Beard as they go in for respective surgeries in the next few weeks. We pray that you might be gracious and even provide a gracious and good outcome in their surgeries. Be with their families. Thank you for their godly parents. And we do pray for the increased amount of people in town, particularly who have committed themselves to alcohol, Lord. We pray that you might break this addiction over their lives and that you might bring them to saving faith in Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray that we might be provided the help, appropriate help in what ways that we can. Help us live holy and obedient lives for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen. Emma, I invite you back as she leads us in a final song.
John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever believes in him shall have eternal life. Please stand as we sing together a cappella style, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
May God be with you as you pass this week.